Hi everyone and welcome to The Chrissy B Show, the UK's only TV programme that's dedicated to your mental health and well-being. Well, today is a big one as we are celebrating World Mental Health Day, which is on Monday the 10th of October. And this year's theme is Psychological First Aid, which is an evidence-informed approach that is built on the concept of human resilience. It's also known as PFA, and it aims to reduce stress symptoms and assist in a healthy recovery following a traumatic event, a natural disaster, public health emergency, or even a personal crisis. World Mental Health Day is designed to get the nation talking about these issues. Now, when terrible things happen in communities, whether that be abroad or close to home, it's very important that we reach out a helping hand to those in need and feel comfortable in doing so. So no matter who you are, learning the basics of psychological first aid will help you to provide support to people who are in distress and importantly to know what to say. So my guests today are our resident psychologist, Dr. Audrey Tang, Babak Sayer, who has been through many things in his life, including seeing people being killed. We also have child and family therapist, Simon Dermody, on the importance of family, as well as hearing from Jonathan Ford, who has documented the lasting effect his career in oil trading had on his mental health. And finally, we'll have our doctor's answers section later, where Dr. Rob Hicks will answer all our medical questions. But first, before all of that, let's see Helena with the news. Welcome to the show, Helena.
Thank you, Chrissy.
So, World Mental Health Day has come round again.
It has, and it's the same story as always. Yes. Huge amount of things. So I'm going to talk about mental health in general and some case studies. So beginning with actually the well-being industry, which is completely booming at the moment. And I was watching a TV programme the other day. I don't know whether you've seen it. No, you wouldn't have seen it. But
Because I was away, let's just...
Yeah, okay. Yeah, it wasn't that you don't watch TV. Well, you don't watch much, but anyway. So more people seeking alternative ways to deal with stress and depression. And it's a really quite fun, well, I find it really interesting. It's on Monday evenings, a BBC series, and it's called The Retreat. Mm-hmm. And it stars Nick Knowles and all of his friends, and they undergo a sort of detox program in Thailand. And you get to know about their mental and physical issues as they're hoping to overcome them. And he's exhausted. It's something I can relate to, although I'm not quite as bad. Exhausted, stressed, he just can't switch off, and he's trying to change his head and his inner space around. So Monday nights, it's an interesting one to watch. It's really good fun. So,
but not if it's the same time as a Chrissy B show.
Oh no, it's not. It's right. absolutely not.
Just making that clear, right?
No. And you can always watch it on catch up. Interesting, Lady Gaga recently speaking about her struggle with anxiety and depression, which is always good. But there's a slight twist in that. Obviously, we like to have celebrities or people that are well known talking and about it in a positive way. But she did say something which was a little bit controversial, in that she said that she wouldn't encourage young people to take antidepressants or mood stabilisers. Now, it was a little bit out of context because it's almost like treating it like drugs, as in casual drugs. And of course, you know, obviously prescribed by a GP, they can be very helpful. So something that I think people need to learn, you can't just make these statements because people will believe you. I think last week as well, we spoke about Bruce Springsteen and his new book, Born to Run. And how his father couldn't stand him, really, I think, in his own words. And he was bullied, and I think his father and him vied for mother's attention, so there was always a fight. But looking at how parents or anybody can really, you know, cause mental problems, is a really lovely story. I don't know if you remember Jermaine Douglas, and he was a 2012 X Factor star, very sweet
probably
boy.
If I saw the face.
He bravely recently admitted, actually on ITV, he struggles daily with suicidal thoughts.
Really?
Yeah, wow. He's such a lovely guy, and it's quite a story. So he opened up about his 18-year torture that his mother suffered at the hands of his father, 18 years, and the impact his abusive father still has on his life. And he talked about it, and he was saying it's just so important for people, again, like him, who've got a platform, to be completely honest.
Yeah.
You know, don't make out your life is rosy. If not, talk about things.
It's good that he's talking about it. But is he getting help?
I think he is.
I hope so.
And I think the good thing is, the one statement he said, I know everything was horrific, but God has a purpose, and I uplift other people going through the same thing with my music. He's a great singer. And also his mum, Mandy, is now part of talking about how she suffered, which is really good. And he's got a new book, and she's also it's called You Can't Run, and she's also Survivor Ambassador of the charity Women's Aid, which is good. James Arthur, he is part of the Glitch campaign and is a big ambassador for mental health charity SANE. Not so keen on James Arthur, but anyway, just one of those things. 82% of Australians say loneliness is increasing, which is quite interesting. And loneliness is also the next great money spinner. And there's a great story, we haven't got very much time to talk about it, about Chuck McCarthy, who's the people walker, and just literally walks people around the park and talks through things.
That's nice.
And sort of, you know, talk more through it, but it's really good fun. Miranda Hart, funny lady, very funny lady.
Yes,
she's 43 now. She was left lonely, isolated and depressed. She had a very, very bad breakup. And she's talked about it in her new book called Peggy and Me. And she talks about her little furry friend who got her through it. And we all know how lovely animals are.
Yes.
And how much support they can give. So that's a really lovely story. Aww. Just ending quickly on Ted McDermott, and he's 80 years old, and he has become an internet sensation, which is so lovely. He's 80. He suffers with dementia. But he has now released a single signed by Decca Records after millions of people saw him on YouTube. But he, James Corden's karaoke carpool, I don't know whether you've seen that before, but his son did is he drove around in the car and filmed them all singing, him singing, which was absolutely so positive for the father. And now he's released You Make Me Feel So Young, which is a Sinatra song, and he's raising money for the Alzheimer's Society.
Oh,
so how lovely is
that? That's lovely. Helen, thank you so much.
Thank you, Chrissy.
And we'll see you again next time for the news. Thank you. All right, guys, so as we've discussed, raising awareness about mental health issues is vital, and this can come from many different places, some through days such as this, some through charities and festivals, other times it can be expressed through art, as was the case for Mark Seymour, a documentary photographer who documented his father's life living with dementia through a series of photographs. Let's hear more from him at his exhibition at the Andipa Gallery in Knightsbridge.
Photographs we see here started developing organically and naturally. I didn't actually set out to do a project of my dad. I didn't set out to cover his life as he was dying or as he was had Alzheimer's. I just photographed my family all the time. Having said that, I did step it up when he was diagnosed. But there was no plan to make an exhibition at that point. Everything you see here was shot just from the heart and was done to document, you know, my dad and my family. But when I was taking the pictures, I felt quite easy to take. But when I was processing the images in front of the computer screen, that's when the tears came and the realization came, and it was quite hard hitting to see Dad on a screen and then go through that processing, and that's when the tears came. By taking these photographs and by showing these photographs, the awareness is raised has been immense, and the amount of people that have come to me and told me their story or the amount of people that it resonates with is unbelievable. You know, almost everyone has got a story to tell you because they know someone with dementia or Alzheimer's, and it's great that it's, you know, now getting awareness and that, you know, we're looking for cures for dementia. A lot of people, they don't understand what someone goes through or what happens to a person in this condition, but by looking at these images, these 20 images here, you can tell a story. The period from the first to the last is about 4 years. Having said that, the period from mum crying with the nurse to the end is less than 12 months. So 50% of them is less than 12 months. I think, you know, going back to what I said initially, this didn't start off as a project. So as a professional photographer, I have projects that I'm working on and I keep going back and revisiting them and developing them. But this was just part of everyday life, so it grew organically. It makes me realise, you know, that there's nothing more powerful than, you know, pure documentary images, because it tells a story. And you can pose someone and it never tells a story. It may be a nice portrait of that person and a beautiful photograph, but the best photographs in the world are those that tell stories. And you know, with this type of photography, you can make people laugh, you can make people cry, you can make people happy, and only observational documentary photography can do that. If I say from a journalistic point of view, the most powerful images, I think it's the last two in the series, they're the most powerful. But if I have, say, my favourite image, it's the portraits of Dad, the one with his harmonica, and the picture of Dad outside his home, where they've lived their whole lives. They're the images that, you know, I want to go away with. And when Mum came to see the exhibition the other week, I said, let's just look at these last two images and let's go away with these thoughts with Dad with a smile on his face.
So thank you very much to Mark there. So after the break, we'll be hearing from Babak Sayer about his traumatic journey from living in the shadow of war to nearly losing his wife, and to child and family therapist Simon Dermody. Welcome back to our show, everybody, which is in support of World Mental Health Day. So now it's time to speak to our first real life story guest, and that's Babak Sayer. Hello, Babak.
Hi, Chrissy.
Great to have you on the show.
Thanks for having me.
So I know you've got quite a story and we don't really have much time to cover everything, but can you tell us in a nutshell what the kind of things that you've been through?
Well, I'm a survivor of the 8-year horrific war that became a war of the 20th century. And as a teenager, I kind of lived without parents. Mm-hmm. With my younger brother, we'll be facing the supersonic explosion almost every day. Goodness. And running across the room by holding our ear and shouting for each other just to see if we are okay. Not knowing if we can survive for the next 24 hours, we just kind of went day after day, week after week, and tried to survive.
How old were you at the time?
I was 12 years old.
12.
I think I was 12, yeah.
Wow. And how did you actually cope, I would say, with all that, so much fear going on?
Well, I guess I had no other choice. Mm. If you see the, you know, my mother kidnapped by the Iraqi armed soldier, and my father was working in the hospital, and me and my brother had no other choice to do rather just kind of escaping from here to there and living in the ruined apartment that bombed by the enemy air force. So we had no choice.
Wow. And Babak, you actually saw quite a few traumatic things, didn't you?
That's right, yes.
So you were seeing people killed and...
Yeah, it wasn't very nice, pleasant, but I think it was something that enabled me to be more courageous and stand up for what I can do. Me and my brother, I remember we slipped behind the green big metal door with my dad. Mm-hmm. And then in the morning, we were terrified because often the mobs come and kick the door and want to get in. And we all sleep under the same blanket. And when that happened, my father had put his hand in front of my mouth and saying, be quiet, don't say anything. And a couple of minutes later, when they gone, he told me, now is the time to go. I think that became a kind of a mental phrase for me to know there is a time to stand up and there's a time to move forward.
And Babak, I just wanted to ask you, because it wasn't just the things that you went through in your country, you actually then later on in life, I wish you had more time to explore your story because I know you have so much to say, but later on in life as well, you had issues with your wife being ill.
Yes. After I forced to leave my home country because of my Christian faith, I came to UK with empty-handed and I could not speak a word of English. So I managed to get through, go to the university, get my degree, married, and then my wife got ill after that. So he struggled with the restlessness and need to have a lot of rest and kind of get the energy back. Yeah. And beside that, my son also diagnosed with the autism. And we struggled to find a place for him because at school to school, they rejected us and say we don't have a fund or we don't have the people to look after him. And that kind of added to my kind of challenge that I was facing.
Babak, how did you get through everything?
Well, I tried to invest in myself because I knew I'm not the only person facing that kind of the challenge. Mm-hmm. And there should be people worse than me. So I tried to find that what other people deal with that one and how I can do the same thing.
But do you have like any maybe advice for viewers that are watching now, Babak, that have been through maybe not exactly the same thing, obviously, that you've been through, but, you know, they've come from a country where, you know, things were really hard, or they've been through something similar with a family member and it's been really difficult. What advice would you give to that person?
I would say ask first, what do you really want? Because most of us live on the true lies that we born and grown up with. You know, certain rule, certain values, certain references that we believe they are truth, but they are not really. So I challenge those, and like my son, they say, you know, he never get healed, cannot get over it, and I don't believe that's one, because I know there are people who overcome that.
Okay.
So yeah, I ask a question, what do you really want? Who have that resolve and how can you model it?
Okay, brilliant. Great advice. Babak, thank you so, so much for speaking
to
us today. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, as we've seen with Babak, their family is a vital contributor towards our mental health. Now, here to talk a bit more about that with me is child and family therapist Simon Dermody. Hello, Simon.
Hello, Chrissy. It's lovely to be here. Thank you.
It's lovely to have you on the show. So, obviously, you heard Babak's interview there. What did you think about his story?
Gosh, I just say straight away, what a courageous, heroic man he is. Mm-hmm. You know, is there anything more that decimates families than war? I can't think
it's
of anything.
Terrible, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. And it's clear that, you know, that war split up his family. Mm-hmm. He was cut off as the elder brother from his father and his mother, and he knew he had to take on this protective, nurturing role for his younger brother. Yeah. And really sort of assume that parental responsibility. And he really stood up to that challenge, and it helped him and his younger brother survive in those extraordinary circumstances. And he provided that protection and nurturing and continuity of care that families do. That's what they do. Yeah. They provide this protection, this nurture and continuity of care.
Now, in his case, he seemed quite positive, didn't he? But as we were saying earlier, that might sort of affect him or have affected him later on in life with the trauma and everything.
I think it's inevitable that he will have what we glibly refer to now as post-traumatic stress disorder to a significant degree. But the actual reality of that is really, gosh, very, very difficult to live with. Mm-hmm. The nightmares, the recurring themes people have experienced of actually being back literally in that place and time. And they struggle with mood swings, they have to try and look after themselves and then they get involved with substances. So they need a lot of psychological and psychotherapeutic care. Mm-hmm. There is a guy, you know, working in the States who's probably the world pioneer in working with military, ex-military men called Skip Rizzo that I've met through the internet. Mm-hmm. And he's done a fantastic job. He's worked with, you know, 80,000 war veterans, right wow. back from the Vietnam War to the present war. And he uses games and adapts these sort of warrior games mm-hmm. and uses them, but in a therapeutic way okay. so that he can help debrief these victims of post-traumatic stress disorder who still come through his door, you know, 30, 40 years after the actual experience.
Really? Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
Gosh. Now, Sam, let's bring this now closer to home, because obviously people suffer trauma for all sorts of reasons, and one of the, especially maybe a lot of the kids maybe in the UK go through trauma when parents divorce or when families split up in some way. Can you tell us a bit about that?
Well, family breakup is probably the biggest issue now that families have to deal with, and I'm afraid here in the UK we're a culture that is experiencing all sorts of stresses for the family. And as we know from the statistics, 50% of children now, by the time they reach the age of 16, have gone through at least one family breakup.
Yeah.
But, you know, statistics really do lie in many ways, because nobody really knows how the family is organised now in our culture, mm-hmm. because there's so many ways for it to work.
Yeah.
You know, essentially a family is one parent and a child. And if you get multiplications of that, that's fine. Mm-hmm. But we have families, we have single parent families, yeah. we have couples who cohabit and have children and stay together, we have couples who cohabit, have children and separate, and families mm-hmm. break up and children have to deal with that. We have couples who get married and they get divorced and then they remarry, mm-hmm. and some of those families stay together and some split up. So it's a very mixed poly sort of glot situation we have, trying to still make it work. But I'm afraid the real casualties of divorce, and after my years of listening to them, are children.
Mm, yeah.
You know, for them, it's what I call a developmental train crash. They didn't want it, they have no choice about it, they have no control over it, and it always comes with traumatic impact for them.
How do you help children in that situation and families that are going through that?
Well, the first thing is parents have to recognise that they need help with their kids. So they need to come through the door. And
would
say,
that be
look.
Like, obviously, from their behaviour, like maybe they're quieter than normal?
Sure,
are this kind
sure.
of?
Well, in the initial stages of the crisis of breakup, children get very spooked and very scared. And they tend to regress in their behaviour. They look to cling for the security that they want to know is still there. And parents have an immense challenge to give that reassurance and security that although mummy and daddy no longer love each other and aren't going to live together and the family is going to change, that their love as a parent is going to be just as strong. So they have to give that message very, very clearly in those first few days and weeks and months. Even so, young children get frightened. Some of them get sort of separation anxiety, they have problems with bedwetting, they won't go to school, they're sad, some children blame themselves. So, you know, all of these feelings come with the actual reality of the family breaking up.
Yeah, okay. And then the kind of help, Simon, that can be offered for these children, what would you say would be the best thing?
I think it's a combination of being able to sit down with children and depending on their age, use the language that works for them. Mm. I mean, play therapy is great. Getting children to draw their feelings, to show their happy face, their sad face. Yeah. I work with a thing called the two homes drawing, which is children go from having the one home and very quickly they have to learn to be able to stay in one home and leave that home and go and live in another home for some of the time and then say goodbye to that home and come back. So when you ask children up to the age of about 12 or 13 to draw two homes and a path between the two, you can get into all that stuff that they have to deal with about.
It's
interesting.
Really good, yeah.
And children will always open up to you. They will always open up to you. For teenagers, it's more complicated, but perhaps we can talk about this in a moment.
Okay. Tell us about Family Steps as well, Simon.
Okay. Well, Family Steps was an initiative that we felt we could take with this tablet generation of children. Mm. We knew that they were app conscious, that they were app users. And so we thought, how could we use these play therapy and family therapy techniques and get them into some kind of animation experience in an app that would be able to talk to the children and their parents? So that was really the concept. And I woke up with it about 4 years ago in the middle of the night with this strange, wacky idea and thought, how could we do that? So that's really where we went with it. It took us about 3 years to actually deliver it and make it. And it's been out there now. We've got 20,000 users and downloads this year. And we've got two apps. One's a fun thing for kids called Make My Family, and the other's is Kids and Divorce, which does what it says on the tin, you know. Yeah. It's a story-making framework in animation for kids to be able to work with a parent and go through the whole experience of making a family breakup. And then also building towards the future with my new home and my wish history. And
That's a great idea. And do you find that kids are more sort of open to express themselves through the app rather than face-to-face, maybe?
Yes. I suppose the app is a kind of adaptation into the digital world and framework of the experience of play therapy that I talked about, say, doing that drawing. But also taking it into what we call the family therapy view as well, being able to work with a parent. Because I think being able to help a family with this major life event and trauma of a family breakup, one's always using an individual and a family approach combined.
Yeah, excellent idea. Simon, thank you so much for speaking to us. Hopefully have you on again soon.
That'd be great.
Thank you. Right, guys, so don't go away, because after the break we'll be hearing from our resident psychologist, Dr. Audrey Tang. Hi, I'm Chrissy B, and my show is all about improving your mental health and being happy. Join me every Monday, Wednesday and Friday at 10 p.m. on my channel Sky 203. Visit chrissybshow.tv for more information and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Chrissy B Show. You can also follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Chrissy B Show and on our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show. Welcome back to our show today, everyone. All in support of World Mental Health Day, we are speaking about psychological first aid. Now, we were supposed to have another guest on called Jonathan Ford, who was going to tell us about his struggles with mental health issues following working in the oil industry. But unfortunately, we couldn't get hold of him today. We had some technical issues. But we do promise that we will be having his interview on the show very soon. But now it's time to talk to our resident psychologist, Dr. Audrey Tang. Hello, Audrey.
Hello, Chrissy.
Lovely having you back on the show.
Thanks for having me. It's lovely to be here.
So we're talking about psychological first aid. Can you break that down for us and tell us what that actually is?
Yes, it is a model of intervention, and it's usually used after a very traumatic event. It could be an explosion, it could be a war zone. It's usually for first responders. However, the techniques used with it are actually very good no matter who you are. If you're a neighbour responding at the first time to help somebody, if you're a parent responding to a child, a teacher, and so on. So actually the principles are really important. Okay. It can be probably summarised best by the World Health Organisation. They say it comprises three things. I'd like to add two more to them. Mm-hmm. The first is to look. Now, what they mean by look is make sure that person that you're supporting and you are now in a safe place. Okay. Look around, make sure everything is okay. If you are about to enter a burning building and you put yourself in jeopardy, then you have to be rescued as well. You are not actually the solution, you're now causing the problem. So it's a case of taking in what's happening and moving to the safe place. That's the most important thing first. The second thing is, of course, then to listen. Now, this doesn't have to happen on the spot. This can happen a little bit later, and it may not be suitable for everybody. So if somebody doesn't want to talk, don't force them to talk. It may not be right for them at that time. But when we talk about listening, it's active listening. It's not just nodding and kind of, hearing, you know, it's what my other half likes to do. But it's not that, it's not that sort of listening, it's active. So the best thing to do is actually being able to paraphrase. It's what you do as an interviewer, paraphrasing what people say, repeating it back to them, and that draws out more of their experience. The next thing is to link them up, whether it is linking them up with, this is the person that's going to be able to help you find your family, this is the network that's available to you, this is the people, the person you can go to for help, linking them up with the people who can support them. Okay. So look, listen and link are the three key words.
However, and Audrey's ones.
I'd like to also add, these are also part of it actually, okay, but yeah, just sort of summarise, empower them. Usually psychological first aid happens when you're in a situation where the normal rules no longer apply anymore, which means that person often feels a severe loss of control. Whatever happened couldn't be predicted, couldn't be dealt with, it couldn't be managed in that way. And so it's quite important to empower them again and give them that control back. Mm. So it's not about forcing them to do something they don't want to do, it's about listening, finding out and offering that support to help them with what they need. And the last one is actually to offer hope. What I mean by that is not promise that everything's going to be okay, because you don't have the power to do that, unfortunately, as much as you may want to. But it's about saying, if you need help, again, I'm going to be here. You can come back to me, giving them an option to return. So, yeah, in summary, it's look, make sure everything is safe, listen to what's needed, link them up with people, empower them, and give them hope.
That's brilliant. Audrey, I also have some points here, some do's and don'ts that were actually posted on the Mental Health Foundation's website. Just to add to what you've said, I'm going to read them out and then maybe if you can elaborate a bit more. So these are the do's that I'm going to read first of all. They're saying, do, be honest, be trustworthy and be open. So they're saying, respect the person's right to make their own decisions, even if you disagree with them. Be aware of and remove your own biases and prejudices, as these may only disrupt and confuse the person even more.
Absolutely. You're helping them. It's not about you. It's got to be focused on them. And what is really important is actually not promising them anything that you can't deliver. Mm. And it's awful. If you're dealing with a child, the thing you want to do is actually make those promises, because that's almost the language that the child likes to speak in. But you can't do that, because if you cannot follow through, then actually you've left that child in a worse position than
and they're not trusting anymore. Yeah. Okay. They're also saying, do offer a lifelong helping hand, which you touched on. So make it clear to people that even if they refuse or don't need help now, they can still access it at any point in the future. And also it's saying, which I think is quite important, don't take offence if somebody isn't ready to talk or open up to you. Just try to be there when they are. Because it can be like, especially if it's a family member trying to do this, and then it's like, oh, they don't want to talk to me, so they don't love me, they don't care, they think I'm not trustworthy. Yep. But it's not that. It's not, again, it's not about...
It's not about
them. Yeah,
absolutely.
And then keep it confidential. So they're saying respect privacy and keep the person's story confidential as appropriate, of course.
Yes.
Spreading somebody's story when they are not ready to have it heard by others can seriously damage their mental health further.
That's one of the most important things in the social media generation. It's so easy to, you may be thinking you're doing the right thing by trying to seek help for somebody, but posting that on a social media platform could be awful. But I will just pull out the confidentiality element. Yeah. Of course, you say as appropriate. It's the sort of thing, again, when you're speaking to teachers, who often are the people who respond first to a child who needs help. You can't promise confidentiality, because if it's about harm to that person, or to somebody else, and so on, you're going to have to tell somebody. Yeah. So sometimes you may even have to say, there will be times where I may have to seek help, but I will go with you to do that.
Yeah, definitely, so, I agree with that. And also it says, do behave appropriately. So take into account the person's age, culture and gender, and tailor your approach to them.
Absolutely. Yes, I mean, it's the cultural thing is also, it's something as very simple as, some cultures, it's not appropriate to look you in the eye. And we, in the Western world, you expect someone to look you in the eye because it's honest. But if that's not the culture, then that person may feel as if they're disrespecting you if they look up. And so it's about finding out as much information as you can about the situation and about the people that you're supporting if you are going to be a first responder. That's in the formal context. Yeah. In the informal context, it's a little bit more trial and error, but it doesn't hurt to be aware of those things.
That's a really good point. And also now they're talking about some don'ts, and they're saying, don't exploit your relationship. So, for example, I don't know who in the right mind would do this. So don't ask the person for money or for any favours for helping them. This suggests you are not helping them from the heart, and this is what people need in a crisis situation. They will lose faith and trust in you and potentially see you as an enemy as a result.
Absolutely.
That one is so important.
I find that so sad that's
even there.
On there. That,
I know.
That frightens me. But yeah, absolutely. That's not why you're there. That's not why you're doing that particular job at all.
That's right. And also the saying, don't lie. So this can be difficult. In certain extreme circumstances, a white lie can be seen as benefiting the individual. But in the vast majority of time, honesty is the best policy, as any information you do cover up will return to haunt them later on. Yes. It's better to be upfront from the beginning so you can prepare correctly. Similarly, don't make promises you cannot keep or believe in or give false information, which
Absolutely.
Is what you said already, Audrey.
Absolutely. It is all about you finding out the information that you need in order to help them. If you can't help, and again, when you want to do that sort of work, you're a very compassionate person and you want to make everything all better, but sometimes the best thing you can do is say, well, I won't be able to help you with this specific thing, but I know someone who can.
Yeah.
And sometimes giving that contact, going with them to that contact, that's the best way of helping.
Yeah.
I mean, we've touched on this before when we've talked about, say, supporting a family member with depression or needing to go and see professional help. Sometimes all you can do is go with them. Don't try and counsel them, but actually go with them to that professional.
Yeah. And we've got another one here. It says, don't exaggerate yourself. If you claim to know more than you do, this will reveal itself eventually, and that can leave the individual in a more vulnerable state.
Yeah.
So, and actually, I think you gain more trust and respect if you are honest, because I remember when I was going through my mental health issues, I remember asking a question to someone, and they were so honest, and they said, look, I don't actually know the answer to this, but I'm going to go ask someone else that's got more experience. I'm going to find out and then come back to you. And he did. And for me, that was fine.
Yeah.
I knew I could trust him because he wasn't just going to say anything to me.
Exactly. There is no shame in saying, I don't know.
Yeah.
And it's ego that makes us do it. Pride, arrogance, whatever it is. But there's no shame in that. If you can't be expected to know everything. Find out as much as you can. But if you don't know, the best thing you can do is, exactly as you said, find out the answer and come back and give the answer.
We've got two more don'ts for you. They also say, don't force yourself on people. Even when you might be desperate to help somebody, don't force them into doing something or telling you something they are not ready to part with. Pressuring people and being intrusive and pushy is not the right approach.
Absolutely.
That can make someone close up even more, couldn't it?
Of course.
And then they have here, number five, don't judge. We are all human and we can all have bad things happen to us. Some just get more bad than others. Remember that what the person is going through could equally have happened to you, and ask yourself honestly, would I have reacted any differently? It's important to empathize and understand there is no right way of reacting to trauma, which is very important.
Really, when you're talking about psychological first aid, it is used in, as I said, a place where rules don't apply, normal rules don't apply. Yeah. So it is a very traumatic situation. However, a lot of the techniques can be applied to a less traumatic situation, or it's still emotionally traumatic, but we're not talking about a war zone situation.
Yes. Yeah. Audrey, thank you so much for helping us out
thank
with
you.
Those tips.
Absolute pleasure.
And we'll see you again very soon.
Yes, thank you.
All right, guys, well, do not go away, because after the break, we'll have our super duper resident doctor, Rob Hicks, and he's going to be answering viewer questions about any medical issues you may have. So if you want to post a question through, you can do so on info@chrissybshow.tv. I'll see you after this. Welcome back to our programme today in support of World Mental Health Day. We have been speaking about psychological first aid, and if you've missed the beginning of the programme, you'd like to catch all of that because it is very useful, do head over to our YouTube channel in a few days' time, Chrissy B Show. Subscribe while you're there and you can watch it all there. So now I have with me our resident doctor, Rob Hicks, and we're going to be answering some viewer questions, Rob, because as we always say, physical and mental health is very closely linked. Can you tell us why?
They are linked. I mean, we should never look at them in isolation. You should look at the physical, you should look at the psychological, and actually we also look at the social too. You know, that's the three parts of our health, because a lot of the time the symptoms we're feeling may be coming from an organ in the body, but also it may be actually a problem with the mind. Okay. And the mind is creating that symptom, let's say a tummy ache, because the person's ignoring that there's stress going on or anxiety going on. So the mind is saying, look, I'm going to create a symptom that you are going to take notice of.
Yeah.
And it will make you seek advice.
That's so interesting.
So you can get the symptom from two places. One, the actual part of the body, or two, it's actually coming from the mind and just being created in another part of the body.
That's so interesting. All right, guys, so we are going to be, not me, Rob's going to be answering your question. I'll try if you want, but I'm probably going to get it all wrong.
You could have a go.
I could have a go, but I won't, not today. So if you'd like to email a question through, you can do so on info@chrissybshow.tv. And don't worry, you can write anything because we're not going to read out your names or anything. We're just going to read the question. Okay, Rob, ready?
Off we go.
Okay, right. So this person's saying, I'm constantly feeling nauseous. It's now at the point where I choose not to eat if I feel sick because I completely lose my appetite, which is making it worse. Also, sometimes I have really bad headaches that last for 5 to 10 minutes, consisting of sharp pains in the head and over the eyes. I also have shooting pains in my lower abdomen. But whether this is linked to the nausea, I don't know. Do you know what it could be?
Well, I've got a few good ideas. Well, I hope they're good ideas anyway. Mm-hmm. Those symptoms could be linked, but they may be completely individual with two different conditions. So depending on whether you're a man or a woman, nausea for women can often mean that they're pregnant. So if that might be a possibility for you, you ought to have a pregnancy test. One of the things that we find with nausea and people filling up, feeling full quickly when they're eating and it puts them off their food, particularly if they've got tummy pains as well, is good old constipation. Because actually the moment you start to eat, you feel uncomfortable, you feel a bit sick, and that puts you off your food. And actually by not eating, you can make the constipation worse. So you get into this vicious cycle. Another thing to think about is, are you taking any medication? And that includes herbal supplements or anything from the pharmacist. Because it might be that one of the side effects of the treatment you're taking, taking appropriately, is that it's causing the nausea. So certainly have a look at the information leaflet that comes with any treatments that you've got, or have a chat with your GP or with your pharmacist. Now, you did mention headaches, and it could be that's down to something like migraine. It could be because of screen time, that you're spending too much time in front of a computer. But you say about the nausea, you say about being off your food, you say about tummy pains, you say about headaches. That could be because of stress and anxiety. Mm. They could be very, very clearly emotional related problems, which, as we talked about earlier, are creating these physical symptoms to attract your attention to it. The bottom line is, with these symptoms, you need to get them checked out. And 9 times out of 10, there's a straightforward solution. So don't hesitate to have a chat with a GP and let's find out what's going on so you can be treated appropriately.
Right. Okay, next question. I'm a 26-year-old male and a delivery driver, so I have quite a manual job. I sweat quite a bit while working, especially in the heat we've been having. Well, maybe this was a little while ago because it's not so cold, not so hot now. However, the last few months, I keep smelling badly, not just whilst working, as I have a second office job. I'll also start smelling during this job, which is once a week, and it's just sitting at a desk all day. I literally shower every day and try to change my hygiene products, but it hasn't helped. I hate this problem, and I want to know what it can be and how I can solve it.
Well, this sounds very much like the typical problem of body odour, and it's not only just a physical problem, but primarily for people with body odour, it becomes an emotional problem. Mm-hmm. It embarrasses them, it affects their self-esteem, it stops them from becoming social because they're terrified of people smelling the odour and being put off, and sadly, people can be really quite unkind to people who have not just body odour but skin conditions. Now, I would say to you, there are lots of things you can do to sort this out. Now, you've already said that you're showering every day, so that's very, very good. Make sure you pay attention to those areas of the body that produce a lot of sweat, because the smell isn't coming from the sweat. The smell is coming from the bacteria that live on the skin, digesting the sweat, feeding on the sweat, and in the process of that, they release the chemicals that causes the smell. So focus on washing the armpits, for example, because we make a lot of sweat in our armpits. Make sure that you're wearing clean clothes every day, and ideally natural fibres like cotton, because that helps the sweat evaporate. The less time the sweat is on the body, the less chance the bacteria have of consuming the sweat and therefore producing those odorous chemicals. You might want to think about changing your diet a bit. Spicy foods can often be smelled in sweat, and that contributes to the odor that people may sense. And there is actually some research that suggests that if you cut down your red meat consumption, you're likely to produce less odour as well.
Really?
So there's, we don't know why, but the research has highlighted that. So that's something to consider as well. So lots of things that you can try. And of course, don't forget, you know, deodorants and antiperspirants, and your doctor is able to recommend a stronger form of antiperspirant that will actually, you know, stop a lot of the sweating happening in the first place. And last but not least, I know you're a male and you may not want to do this, but if you shave your arms or your armpits, then again, you're less likely to have the accumulation of the sweat, which the bacteria can feed on. So that may help. That might be something to try.
That's a good idea. Okay, next question. I have a swollen lymph node under my jaw. It moves and is painful if I press on it. But it's small though. I searched online and it says this could mean cancer. People shouldn't search online, should they? I'm only 15. I'm very scared and I wonder if this is actually cancer or if it can be something else.
Okay, now you're clearly going to be scared by this. And the important thing, with any lump, the best way of making a diagnosis is for a doctor to actually examine it and feel it. So I would urge you to get this checked out. Mm. I would also try and reassure you that the odds of this being cancer are actually very, very slim. It is more likely to be an ordinary lymph gland that has come up when you've had an infection and has stayed up. This often happens. Or it may be that it's been there all the time and something has drawn your attention to it. Say, for example, maybe you were putting on some makeup, maybe you were having a facial treatment and you noticed it. But the bottom line is to get it checked out, because the longer you leave it, the more anxious you'll get, the more worried you'll be. And in fact, that will just cause you two problems rather than just the one. So please don't be hesitant in asking your doctor's advice. You're 15, so if you feel that you want to go on your own, your doctor would be happy to see you. But ideally, take somebody with you, a friend, family member, or a parent.
Okay. Next question. I don't think we're going to get time to finish all of them, Rob, but let's see how much we can get through. This month, I passed out on the bus. It happened a few times before when I was working my first job and had 8-hour shifts and had to be on my feet all day. I also passed out a few times, but I don't know why. I don't usually eat in the morning, and I wonder if this is the cause or if it can be something else.
Well, it could be the cause, couldn't it, if you're not eating a healthy diet on a regular basis. So first thing to do is try having breakfast.
Yeah.
And see if that makes a difference. And the second thing to do is get yourself checked out with your doctor, because it sounds like you're fainting, but what's going through my mind is you're collapsing. So is it that you're actually having an epileptic fit or some kind of epileptic episode, or is it something else? Is it something to do with the heart, where maybe it's the blood pressure's too low or the heart is beating irregularly and that's causing you to pass out? The common causes of fainting, dehydration is one, anemia is another, being in a warm environment is another, side effect of medications can be one, particularly if you're on blood pressure lowering medication, it drops the pressure too low. But bottom line is, eat a healthy diet, try and spend some time sitting down, but please get yourself checked out, because 9 times out of 10, this is simple fainting that can be sorted out very easily, but occasionally it's a more serious condition that again can be treated.
And please eat breakfast, definitely, right?
Yeah, have breakfast.
Most important meal of the day, as they say. Yeah. All right, so next question. For the past couple of weeks, as soon as I open my eyes, I feel nauseous and my heart beats quickly. My brain shocks me awake when I try to sleep. Also, often I wake up and I need to go to the toilet right away.
So lots of different symptoms there. Each of them can have an underlying cause, or they may be linked. Your doctor, when he or she checks you out, will be able to identify whether it's a physical cause. But I think with these symptoms, there is a very good chance that this is a psychological cause, that this is related to stress, anxiety, or depression, particularly the way that you say that the moment you wake up, you're experiencing these symptoms. So have a think about what might be worrying you, because your doctor is going to ask you that question, and it's best to be prepared. So the sort of things he or she may ask is, how long have you had these symptoms for? Does anything make these symptoms worse? Does anything make these symptoms better? Have you suffered these symptoms before and been checked out? So be prepared, rehearse your answers, and that way it's easier for you to communicate how you're feeling, and it's easier for your doctor to actually come to a correct diagnosis.
Brilliant, and we've actually got time for our last question today. I'm 18 years old and I'm the oldest of two. For about 2 years now, there are times when out of nowhere, my chest and sometimes my whole body begins to hurt. At times the pain is bearable, but there's times when the pain gets to me and even makes me cry. What could this be? I'm not taking any medication at all.
Okay, there are a number of different reasons. It might be something as absolutely straightforward as that there are times when you decide you're going to get fit and you overdo it on the exercise, and then the following couple of days you feel achy all over. Or it may be actually that you have a condition such as fibromyalgia, where people get these tender areas around their body, they get muscle stiffness, they feel very fatigued, they have sleep disturbances as well. You've said you're not taking medication, but maybe you might be taking some kind of supplement. Or herbal remedy that may have a side effect. So if you are, have a look at those.
You kind of think that those kind of things don't have an effect.
Yeah, people think that it's natural, therefore it can't have any effect, but they can have side effects. In fact, we say in medicine, you know, if something can have any effect, then it can also have a side effect. Okay. And there are lots of herbs that can have side effects as well, and lots of supplements. So for example, one of the side effects of iron supplements is constipation. Mm. So there's always a positive and a negative.
Yeah, okay.
So again, with this sort of symptom, it may be simply a muscular thing. It may be an underlying condition where this is just one of a number of symptoms, which perhaps, you know, our viewer has thought as normal, and therefore hasn't mentioned to us, but may well mention to her doctor.
Okay. Sorry, I interrupted you. You were still giving some advice to the person, weren't you?
No, well, I think the important thing is when we've got symptoms and we don't know what's causing them, we should get them checked out, which is why you've asked the question. You need to be examined, but also think about what causes these symptoms. You said that they flare up every now and then. Can you keep a diary of the symptoms so you can identify what you've been doing, maybe what you've eaten, what's been on your mind? Because sometimes by looking at a diary for a couple of weeks, you can pinpoint, oh, it's every time I go and do this, or it's every time that neighbour comes and talks to me that actually I get these symptoms of feeling achy and stressed and unhappy.
Okay, very important. Rob, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
And we'll see you again on our next Doctor's Answers.
Thank you very much
indeed. Thank you. All right, guys, so we have reached the end of today's programme. I hope it's been really helpful for you. We've covered the psychological. We've covered quite a few things on the programme. And don't forget to tell people about this show as well for them to watch it on YouTube. And if you have a story that you would like to share, or you're a professional, you'd like to come on and share your expertise, do get in touch with us via the website, chrissybshow.tv. You can also tweet us at chrissybshow, or leave a message on our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show. Until next time, bye for now.